Well, good morning, and can I welcome everybody to this, the fifth meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2022. The first item on the committee's agenda is for members to agree to take agenda items 3, 4, and 5 in private. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. The principal reason why we are meeting this morning is to take evidence on the administration of Scottish Income Tax 2021-22 report, which was produced on the 12th of January this year by the Auditor General, which was in turn a commentary on the report prepared by the National Audit Office. So I'm very pleased to welcome in person this year our four witnesses: Stephen Boyle, the Auditor General for Scotland, who's accompanied by Mark Taylor, the Audit Director at Audit Scotland. I'm also particularly pleased to welcome, I think for the first time in person before the committee, Gareth Davies, who's the Comptroller and Auditor General at the National Audit Office, and he's joined by Darren Stewart, who's an Audit Director at the NAO. So we've got a whole series of questions that we'd like to put to you, but I want to begin first of all by inviting the Auditor General for Scotland to make a short opening statement. Auditor General.
Many thanks, Convener. Good morning, Committee. Scottish Income Tax remains a key part of the package of new financial powers implemented as a result of the 2012 and 2016 Scotland Acts. The purpose of today's session is to look at the administration of Scottish Income Tax. The reports that the Committee has before it relate to the 2021-22 year. This was the fifth year in which the full amount of non-savings, non-dividend income tax collected by HMRC is payable to the Scottish Government. It's also the fourth year that HMRC has published Scottish income tax outturns in its accounts. These outturn figures relate to 2020, 2021, and the difference between actual UK and Scottish tax outturns and the amounts forecasted at the time is then adjusted through the 23-24 budget. All of this is known as the budget reconciliation process. The reconciliation in the 2021 accounts results in an increase to the 23-24 budget of £50 million. This is noteworthy, Convener. It's the first time that there's been a positive budget reconciliation in respect of the Scottish budget. HMRC's annual accounts also include an estimate of Scottish income tax for the 21-22 year, but this is for reporting purposes and doesn't affect the Scottish budget. HMRC collects and administers Scottish income tax as part of the UK's overall income tax system. The National Audit Office audits HMRC's accounts, and the Comptroller and Auditor General is responsible for reporting to the Scottish Parliament on HMRC's administration of Scottish income tax. I then report to this committee to provide additional assurance on the NAO's audit work in line with the recommendation from one of your predecessor committees in 2014. I also explain what this means for the Scottish budget. In summary, Convener, my report says that I'm satisfied with the NAO's audit approach, that it was reasonable and covered the key audit risks. I'm also satisfied that the findings and conclusions in the CNAG's report are reasonably based. The CNAG has concluded that the outturn on Scottish income tax was fairly stated. This, therefore, provides the Scottish Parliament with valuable assurance over this aspect of the Scottish budget. As ever, Convener, my colleagues and I look forward to answering the committee's questions this morning, and I'll pause for any further opening statements from the CNAG. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. I'm going to go straight to Gareth Davies, the Comptroller and Auditor General from the NAO. If you'd like to make a short opening statement, Mr. Davies, and then after that we'll go straight into questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the invitation to give evidence today. I'm delighted to be here in person, as you said. The content of my report, as the Auditor General has explained, follows the requirements set out in legislation, which requires me to report to you on the outturn for 2021 in this case, and also HMRC's estimate of revenue for 21-22. We also look at the rules and procedures in place to administer the system and test through our audit work how those are operating, and then the costs recharged by HMRC to the Scottish Government for this specific work we also cover. So our report sets out our conclusions in those three areas, and I, as the Auditor General has said, In both the case of the outturn for 2021 and the estimate for 21-22, I've concluded that both are reasonable. It's worth pointing out that the context for this work and the years that this report covers, 2021 being the first full year of the pandemic, and we've seen that a small increase actually in the revenue collected through income tax for that year, maybe a surprise to everybody looking forward to this at the outset of the pandemic, expecting a significant decline in tax revenues. But this is a pattern we've seen across the UK, and largely attributable, I think, to the various income support schemes that were put in place to make sure that people were still in employment through that very difficult year. And you will have noticed that the estimate for 21-22 shows a sharp increase from the previous year. So on the one hand, that reflects the reopening of the economy and the extra activity that everyone was able to see in that year. But it also, I think, provides, for this time next year, provides a very good test of the estimation methodology used by HMRC, with clearly a significant increase of more than 11% in 1 year. Will be very interesting to see how the outturn compares to that when we have this report next time. So looking forward to answering the committee's questions on the report. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. And can I kick us off just on the point you were making there? So HMRC estimate that Scottish income tax in 2021 to 22 to be 13.2 million, which is an increase of about 11.3% on the previous year, which of course was a year when the economy was in lockdown. But there is also an estimate that the increase in the UK will be 13.2%, which is, you know, significantly more. Why is there an expected difference, or why is there a difference in the UK performance versus the Scottish performance?
I think Stephen may wish to comment on this as well, but I first of all point to the outturn figure for the previous year, so for 2021, as set out in this report. You'll see there that in that case too, the Scottish figure slightly lags the UK-wide figure. So it's a 1% increase in Scotland and a 2% increase on the previous year for the UK as a whole. In a way, it's not a surprise to see that pattern replicated in their estimate for the following year, because they're obviously using the same methodology to roll forward. So I don't have any kind of more detailed information to elaborate on that, but I don't know, Stephen, whether you have any to comment.
Maybe just briefly, Convener, I think we know that there's real variation and there's increasing divergence in both, I suppose, firstly, the volatility of some of the factors that are set out in the NAO's report as various parts of the UK recover at different rates from the pandemic, also factoring in other external events, the war in Ukraine, still residual impact of UK leaving the European Union, and then volatility more recently as a result of cost of living pandemic. So I think these factors, coupled with, I think, elements of early signs of variation from the divergence of Scottish income tax are all factors. I think probably, as Gareth says, though, that is perhaps going to be the most significant and interesting outturn when we eventually see just how reliable those estimates are. So a combination of those factors, Convener, I think are the early signs that we're aware of. It probably pushes up, I think, to the boundaries which we're able to give precise detail, and the HMRC themselves are the owners of the methodology and will be, you know, to set that out more in more detail should the committee wish.
Thanks. I think Mark Taylor wants to come in on this point too. Mark.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Just really to draw the committee's attention to, of course, there are a number of estimates for what the tax position is likely to be in that subsequent year. And the estimates that go into the Scottish Budget prepared by the Scottish Fiscal Commission, and they'll provide a commentary on where their forecasts are at. And also they provide very helpful and useful commentary on some of the drivers for the differences between the UK and the Scottish position. If it's helpful to the committee, we can perhaps point you in the direction of some of the detail of that.
Yeah, I think that would be helpful. I mean, one of the factors that I think we considered last year, but has possibly been brought more to the fore in this financial year that we're looking at, is the rate of inflation. So, I mean, inflation presumably has led to higher than previous wage settlements, and therefore people's incomes rising, and therefore presumably the tax take from income tax going up. Is that a fair assessment of what's going on?
I think it's hard to disagree with that, convener. Do you think if you see people's incomes rising faster than would have been anticipated? I think we're all seeing that through some of the public sector pay conversations that are happening. So rates that would have been assumed are now higher in reality, and that will feed through to eventually the income tax that HMRC collects.
Might be higher in reality. I'm not sure the higher in real terms, but my point is, if people's incomes are going up, albeit they are lagging behind the cost of living and the overall retail and consumer price index, that presumably leads to an expansion of the revenue that's coming in to HMRC, and that in turn will lead to an increase in resources available to the Scottish Government.
Add that because this is obviously a UK-wide effect as well, which we're seeing in the rest of our work. And the obviously one of the big effects of this is to pull people into higher tax brackets more quickly than may have been expected. So that fiscal drag, as it's called, so this doesn't present a challenge in accuracy of estimation to HMRC, I think, because they're clearly it's a faster-moving target that they're trying to predict. So I think whether they're going to be able to get as close as they did in 2021 between the estimate and the outturn, it'll be very interesting to see.
Yeah, and I think, sorry, Mark Taylor, you want to come in on this?
Yeah, thank you. Just in your comment about the impact on the Scottish budget, essentially. So in overall terms, at UK level, more taxes means increasing budgets. But of course, what matters at a Scottish level is that interplay between the Scottish tax and the increase in Scottish taxes per head, and the rest of the UK or England and Northern Ireland, to be strict, and the increases in taxes there. So it's the interplay of those two factors that drives the Scottish budget. So if Scottish taxes per head increase at a faster rate than at a UK level, then there will be more budget. But even though they may be increasing, but at a slower rate than at a UK level, then that will squeeze the budget.
Yeah, and we will come on to discuss that in more detail. Gareth Davies, you mentioned a couple of times methodology, and that again is something which exercises the interest of this committee, because other members of the committee will come in again on in more detail in this area. But I mean, we are now in a situation where the Scottish income tax is well established. And we've had some concerns that the methodology doesn't really give us the level of data that we think is necessary to make informed policy decisions. And if I can cite one example, I think, you know, you've in the report, you identify some of the methodological flaws, if you like, or recognised areas where there isn't the level of data that we might like. So, for example, if I look at one of the second aspects, the second aspect in the methodology, you say the methodology combines the calculation of PAYE and self-assessment liabilities for the UK such that the amount apportioned to Scotland does not reflect the differing proportions of each type of taxpayer between Scotland and the rest of the UK. I mean, do we know, for example, what the balance is in England, Northern Ireland versus Scotland of those people who are on pay-as-you-earn and those people who are on self-assessment? You know, are there more people on PAYE in Scotland than there are in England and Northern Ireland or vice versa? Mr. Stewart. Daniels. Yeah.
Thank you, Chair. So I don't have the data with me on what that proportionate split is, but it is capable of being derived. So the way in which HMRC calculates the estimate, interrogates and takes extracts from its self-assessment and pay-as-you-earn systems driven by a Scottish taxpayer indicator. So the proportional split that you're talking about should be capable of being derived, absolutely.
So that could be built into the data that's available, but currently it's not. I mean, you know, even on some kind of sampling basis, it presumably would be possible to get a gauge on the relative balance between PAYE and self-assessment in both jurisdictions. The other thing that that I think strikes us is the methodology was something, again, Auditor General for Scotland, that you reflected on last year in your report. And again, I think in paragraph 16, you say paragraph 16 of this year's report, you say, and in fact you're noting the NAO's report, that the methodology has remained broadly the same since the prior year. I mean, we were having conversations with Scottish Government officials as well as HMRC this time last year about the methodology, about the service level agreement, about the quality of data that was being procured, because there is a obviously a financial cost to this. And I think, I mean, if I take Gareth Davies, the comment you made last year, you told us clearly if you had a more highly specified agreement that got into some of the areas we've been talking about today, which is about why can't we get more qualitative data and fewer estimates, it is likely that HMRC would require more costs to be covered. However, on the basis of the agreement that is currently set out, we think that the cost is fairly stated. So in other words, we were getting into the terrain of perhaps if the Scottish Government was prepared to maybe pay a little bit more money to HMRC from that, it could get some better quality data. And indeed, the Alison Stafford from the Scottish Government, who gave evidence last year, said that the committee's consideration is extremely timely for us to take your observations and comments into account. And she talked about that they were looking at data breadth and depth. But nothing appears to have changed. Is that a fair estimate of what's going on here? Nothing.
Well, I don't think anything's changed fundamentally in the system since last year's report. Absolutely. But I just could I just return to your previous question?
Sure.
I just wanted to be. It might be helpful if you could point out the reference to in our report that you were bringing up in relation to the PAYE and self-assessment taxpayers, because I mean I think for the outturn figure for 2021, so in other words the actual figure being reported here, that figure is based on Scotland's PAYE taxpayers and Scotland's self-assessment taxpayers. So I just wanted to check the reference you were quoting to make sure I wasn't missing a chance to help the committee.
Yeah, well, I mean, sorry, I can look it up in your report, but I mean, certainly, I think there were four areas where there was reference made to the methodology. Looking at the, looking at what could be reasonably assessed. So the use of sample data introduces sampling uncertainty. So it's based on sample. So it's, I think it's it's paragraph 1.22 in your report, which has got those four bullet points in it. And so the second point is the methodology combines the calculation.
Yes. This is the estimate for 21-22.
Yeah.
The outturn figure, which is the, if you like, the real figure in this report that relates to tax actually remitted to Scotland, the outturn figure is always based on the actual taxpayers in Scotland. So that 2021 outturn figure we're reporting on here is not an apportionment between PAYE and self-assessment. It's not based on an aggregate of the UK. It's specifically the Scotland figures. So I think that's a really important point. So you can rely on the accuracy of that number as being accurate for Scotland. The para 122 is dealing with the estimate for the year. So, and by its definition, of course, the estimate is before people have completed their tax returns, before HMRC knows exactly what's due from each taxpayer. So for that estimate, they use the apportion method that we're describing in that paragraph. So hopefully that's a helpful distinction between you can rely on the outturn, the estimate is inherently more uncertain.
Yeah. No, and I think that clarification is helpful. So thank you for that. But obviously, the estimates are in the domain of the decision-making process, and so are quite important to us. And that's why, we've taken a view that we think having better data would help, give us a clearer sense of where policy should go and what will have the most impact in terms of raising revenue or redistributing the burden of taxation. Auditor General, do you want to comment?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I think Gareth's distinction is very important, obviously, between the outturn and the estimate. The estimate clearly is used to support decision makers, policy makers in the Parliament and the government about spending commitments into the future. where we get to in drawing on the NAO's conclusions is particularly that as the volatility that you've described and also the increasing divergence between tax rates within Scotland and other parts of the UK, it's our view that it's for the government in Scotland to be satisfied with the methodology and the associated data that they are receiving to help inform their budget setting process. And we broadly reached a point that with the complexity and the divergence, it's for the government to reaffirm their satisfaction with the current arrangements, to test that the quality of the data is still fit for purpose to support their forecasting requirements.
Thank you. One of the factors which is mentioned in the report is the impact of the Omicron variant of COVID and the war in Ukraine. And it suggested that would have an impact on taxpayers' ability to meet their tax liabilities. Could you perhaps elaborate on that, please?
Yes, there's two points that apply to HMRC's work across the whole of the UK, including Scotland. And these were pandemic impacts, including from the Omicron wave, which you remember was the last kind of very big disruption to life in the UK. So the two big factors that have affected HMRC. Firstly, they reduced their compliance activity during the pandemic. If you remember, HMRC was the department tasked with standing up the big programmes for paying furlough, furlough and self-assessment, self-employed income support. So literally thousands of HMRC staff were redeployed onto those tasks, and quite a lot of them came from the compliance teams. So the level of compliance work was lower. We've reported on this for the UK as a whole separately. Actually, I'm very happy to share a copy of that report with the committee if you'd find that helpful. Not surprisingly, what we've seen is a reduction in the level of compliance cases from that and a reduced amount of compliance recoveries. So Scotland, in the estimate, Scotland is bearing a share of that reduced compliance recovery. And the second one is, for the same sorts of reasons, tax debt in the UK has gone up sharply. So taxpayers owe more to HMRC because of inability to pay on time. Some of this was actually caused by HMRC deferring payment dates in the pandemic. But not every taxpayer has been able to catch up, if you like, their payments to HMRC since the pandemic phases came to an end. And so there's now a fairly significant challenge for HMRC in collecting outstanding tax due. And again, that's had an impact on the estimate in the way that we set out in the report for next year. So there's two important factors, UK-wide factors, to be aware of there.
Thank you. And I think later on in the morning, we're going to come on to talk a little bit more about debt collection. But I want to now move on to the Deputy Convener, Sharon Dowie, who's got some questions to put. Sharon.
Good morning. On administration of the Scottish Income Tax, HMRC uses the same systems to administer income tax, whether a taxpayer is from Scotland or from the rest of the UK. It operates additional rules and procedures for Scotland, like residency checks and applying tax codes where individuals are identified as Scottish taxpayers. And the NAO report also states that, as has been the case in previous years, one of the main admin challenges faced by HMRC is maintaining an accurate and complete record of Scottish taxpayer residency addresses, because HMRC relies on taxpayers notifying them of any change of address. So what can be done to improve that? And would a legal requirement to notify HMRC of address changes assist with the admin challenge and overall compliance?
Yes, I mean, this is obviously one of the key areas of compliance control, to make sure that the tax is allocated to the correct country in the system. And the more that we see divergence, just intuitively, the greater the pressure on that system of compliance, and the more the incentives for people to manipulate address, for example, is one of the ways of avoiding what would otherwise be a higher tax payment. So HMRC is obviously fully aware of that risk, and we know that it's a topic that they discuss with the Scottish Government in their regular conversations. In terms of what would represent useful increases in the level of control over those risks, I think that those are really questions for HMRC rather than us. They're the operational experts, and they will give you a much more informed answer than we as their auditors can. But But as you say, legal requirements to notify HMRC, they sound plausible, but I think the experts would need to advise you on whether they would have the desired effect or would they create any kind of perverse effects not intended.
No, okay, thanks. The most recent scan of taxpayers' records to identify missing or invalid postcodes, which would result in incorrect residency status being applied, was in June 2021. And it identified 25,488 missing or invalid postcodes, of which 3,031 were updated. Reported postcodes, whether missing or invalid, represent 1% of the 2.5 million total income tax population in 2020-21. And a small number of missing taxpayers can potentially equate to a large amount of revenue, especially if the group contains high net worth individuals. So has the NEO received an update from HMRC around the monitoring of this situation and specifically the causes of missing or invalid postcodes? What might the impact be on revenues and what, if anything, is being done to address it?
Darren, to pick up that question, please.
Of course, sir. If I take your point first around the causes, so this is clearly a key area of focus we return to every year. As part of our work and in reporting to you. So missing and invalid postcodes can arise for things as simple as keying errors in tax returns and things of that nature. I think the scale of missing and invalid postcodes has fluctuated over time. It is a key feature of the assurance work that HMRC themselves do. I think an important part of that work is interrogating those missing and invalid postcodes to identify where there are residents within those postcodes who are actually liable to tax. And the analysis that they have done does often identify that there aren't tax-paying individuals within those households for various reasons. They could be dormant accounts, they could be economically inactive people, and things of that nature. So you asked about any follow-up that we've had since that exercise in June. We haven't had that. That's something that we'll pick up as part of the forthcoming year's work, but it does remain a key focus of our work. It's really important.
Okay, that's fair.
Yeah, okay, right, okay. Sorry, Craig Hoy's got some questions.
Thank you, good morning, Mr. Davies and Mr. Boyle, and welcome. It's nice to see you in the flesh rather than on Zoom. I just want to delve a little bit deeper on the monitoring and evaluation that you can do around compliance of Scottish income taxpayers, which is becoming a live issue given the increasing divergence between the Scottish tax system and the UK tax system. And indeed, it's something that is referred to in a report by the Institute for Fiscal Studies, which is covered in the Daily Telegraph today. I just want to go back onto that issue that I think the Deputy Convener raised in relation to postcodes and where people are resident. The report says that HMRC has not identified any significant or widespread instance of taxpayers changing their address to obtain a tax advantage. But today's report points to the chief executive of, I think it's DJ Alexander, David Alexander, who says that, and it's Scotland's largest letting agency, that he's already seeing signs of high earners leaving. He said, it's a natural situation that people think, actually, why would I reside here when I can move not far and pay substantially less in tax? Given that the HMRC says that they're not seeing any instances, any significant or widespread instances of that, can you just maybe elaborate in what would be significant or what would be widespread, bearing in mind that Scotland has a very small number of upper rate and high rate taxpayers?
I definitely would have to ask HMRC what they meant by those definitions, because obviously they're their terms, and that's not a kind of auditable bit of the process, if you like, that we could help shed light on. So I'm sure they would be able to help with the detail behind those comments that they've made. What we do know is that they use their database to run the kind of computer checks you would expect in this situation. So running a report to show to list out the taxpayers who've changed their postcodes from a Scottish postcode to an English postcode in the last 12 months. It's not, that's not a, a dauntingly enormous list. Of course, there's quite a lot of people on it in any one year. I don't know what the exact number is, but it's a meaningful audit process to then look for any signs of a pattern of behaviour. So I'd be very surprised if that's not what they're referring to. I suspect that they use those exception reports that they run on a regular basis to assess the volume of transfers cross-border. And of course, there will be some in the other direction for work reasons and personal reasons and all sorts of others. So I'm assuming that their comments are based on their analysis of the data, but they would have to give you the detail behind that.
The divergence is about sort of 2.1%, I think, in relation to the rest of the UK, which is now getting into what I would perceive to be a significant sum. From your perspective, would it be reasonable to expect that those individuals faced with the prospect of higher tax, that there's an incentive for them to look at tax, legitimate tax avoidance measures, which, for example, could be converting income to dividends or potentially moving south of the border? That would be a reasonable expectation that HMRC should be aware of.
Yeah, you're inviting me to go into policy areas, which I can comment on the audit of the numbers, but these are judgments for elected politicians rather than for auditors.
And I think the Auditor General wants to come in on this point too.
Thanks, Convener. I think, Mr. Hoy, I think you picked a really, one of the central themes of our report based on some of the assessment that both HMRC and also, I think, recent commentary from the Scottish Government themselves, the Deputy First Minister's evidence to the Finance and Public Administration Committee, explored some of the emerging risks of change in taxpayer behaviour as a consequence of the divergence in tax regimes between Scotland and other parts of the UK. It probably is early days, I think, is the picture that they're in. HMRC say there is limited evidence, but there is the potential for behavioural change. You mentioned high net worth individuals. I think looking at the analysis within the NAO's report and some of the comparisons of tax implications on different income tax earning rates, as people earn more than the top rate and particularly go much higher beyond the £150,000 threshold, the differential is less. The more significant impact is on people, what might be called as middle earners. £50,000, I think, is the more significant differential. Where that gets us to from the recommendation and judgment that we make in our report is for the Scottish Government to take a view on what kind of additional compliance activity it wishes to ask of HMRC, based on HMRC's position is that there's not enough evidence generally to support that there's this sort of behavioural change having an impact. Whether that's a sustainable position, I think, is something that the government in Scotland and HMRC need to keep under close review and discussion. It's a cost benefit to all of us. Additional compliance activity for Scottish income tax purposes will come at a cost, and to weigh that up against the benefit that it will produce in terms of further tax take.
Yeah. And is it quite difficult to do that modelling in a predictive sense, or do you only realise that maybe the flight has happened once you look back over the output for a year?
I think maybe like Gareth has mentioned, I think it's difficult for us as auditors actually to take a position on. I think that it's the specifics of the modelling and the reliance of it is something for HMRC and their advisers to keep under close review. For the Scottish Government's perspective, they'll want to be satisfied that the compliance activity that they're asking HMRC is consistent, proportionate for their requirements.
And just in terms of your examination, obviously, you came forward with various recommendations in your report. And do you think that there should be more third-party data checks and compliance activity undertaken in Scotland?
I'm sure Gareth and Darren might want to say a bit more about third-party data checks. I think looking at the results of the third-party data checks, that is a position that we've reached, that there is opportunity for the government in Scotland to request more third-party and perhaps more frequent third-party data checks to satisfy themselves about the accuracy and the consistency of the tax base in Scotland, which leads to the totality of the outturn and the reliability of the estimates. But I think colleagues in the NAO could probably say a bit more about that.
I think that's absolutely fair. We've made more than once actually recommendations around the frequency of that third party data exercise. I think in the hierarchy of work that HMRC does and the assurance it provides, third party independent checks are clearly preferable. And when last prompted, HMRC and the Scottish Government settled on a 2-year frequency, which they were comfortable with because they thought it struck the right balance between timeliness and cost. That's something I think we would always recommend that they keep under review. Just going back to a point that was made earlier, I guess where we're attributing HMRC's view that there hasn't been any instances of significant or widespread manipulation, that is very much referring to manipulation. And I guess it is quite important to make the distinction between people who choose to legally move across the border or legally change their tax arrangements versus something which would clearly be of interest to HMRC, where that does strain to manipulation and non-compliance and evasion. I think that it's an important distinction to make.
People are doing it perfectly legitimately over a number of years. It's not something that HMRC would necessarily be particularly activated about.
I think they should be interested in it. I'm not sure they would have the powers to do anything about it, I guess, is the distinction I would make.
Fine. Thank you very much.
OK, thank you. We've got a whole other area that we want to explore around the tax gap and other data issues, so I'm going to bring in Colin Beattie at this point. Colin.
Thank you, Convener. Over a number of years, I've been fairly critical about the quality of the Scottish rate of income tax and all the estimates and so on that are around it. Last year, I drew up a list of 32 areas where there are estimates or, more accurately, perhaps guesstimates as to what the figures might be. And looking at this report here, I will do the same. I haven't had time yet, but quite clearly there's evidence there that Scottish figures are inadequate, separate Scottish figures, to enable an accurate calculation of the tax. There's also conflation with UK figures at times because separate Scottish figures not being available, and yet the mix of taxpayers in Scotland clearly is quite different from the rest of the UK, particularly when you take London into account, which is hugely distorting. Are the figures that we've got for Scottish tax just fantasy, you know?
Okay. Well, I think I'll return to my answer to Convener earlier on. When we're talking about the outturn figures through this system, so in this case we're looking at 2021 outturn, they're definitely not fantasy. They are auditable, and our opinion on those is based on the fact that PAYE and self-assessment forms the vast bulk of that amount. And that 99% of that figure is not an estimate. 99% of that figure is based on actual tax received. So I think you can be very confident in the accuracy of the outturn figure. And that's quite a strong statement for an auditor to make. We don't normally go that far. But in this case, you know, there's a strong evidence base behind the outturn. I think the concerns you've described there do apply to the estimate, as we discussed earlier on. And now that estimate is not a figure that affects the amount collected for Scotland and delivered to the Scottish Government, but it is a relevant figure in the planning system in the way that the Auditor General explained earlier on. So it's important to work on the accuracy of that estimate, but it isn't the same as can you trust the amount of income tax that Scotland is receiving, because that's the outturn, and I think in that case you can. So hopefully that's a helpful starting point to that discussion, but obviously you may want to go into specific areas of the estimate in more detail.
Well, there are one or two areas that I would like to look at more closely, although I would again say that there are an awful lot of estimates in here that I think must distort the final figure. But if I look at paragraph 15, where it states there are no risks identified in the Scottish SPR which are specific to Scotland, as HMRC assesses that compliance risk in Scotland is consistent with the rest of the UK, given the different mix of taxpayers and so on across the rest of the UK, is that actually accurate as a statement?
Well, it's an accurate statement of the view of HMRC, which is our job here, is to give you a kind of clear picture of what their view is. I think you'd have to ask HMRC.
As the auditor, though, you would have a view on that.
Well, we point out in the same paragraph that as we look at a greater divergence maybe between the Scottish tax rates and the UK tax rates, that merits a closer look at that risk assessment. And it would be surprising if it didn't start to feature in a more prominent way in that strategic picture of risk, as it's called, which is why we make the point we do about, as we just discussed, returning to this question about, first of all, is the risk sufficiently well understood given the changing policy picture? And then when the risk is understood, is the level of investment in the controls, the mitigation of those risks, is that proportionate to the level of risk being run? And that's a constantly moving picture. So I don't think you should ever be satisfied with that. You should continue to probe between Scottish Government and HMRC whether they have arrived at the right balance in the way that the Auditor General was describing earlier on between cost and rigour of control. But at the moment, I think it's an accurate picture of how they're running their system of risk assessment. And we're pointing out that the risks are changing, so this will need to be kept under review.
But if I carry on down to paragraph 16, where it states that HMRC calculates these, this is in connection with the compliance yield of 280 million, HMRC calculates these figures as a proportion of the equivalent UK figure, rather than Scotland-specific data to quantify the risks. I mean, to me, that doesn't seem like it could be accurate.
Well, they run the same compliance, as we point out in the report. This figure of 280 million is essentially the return on the compliance activity that, in other words, chasing up suspect cases of underpayment and so on. And as we say in the report, the process that HMRC uses is the same in Scotland as it is for the rest of the UK. So they don't adjust their compliance approach for Scotland, and therefore they think it's a fair estimate to apply the proportion of net losses through the compliance approach and the yield in this case from their compliance work on that basis. Again, this is one that you'll just need to keep probing on, I think. As the circumstances change and the risks change, this assumption may well become unsafe at some point. But HMRC's assessment is currently that it remains the best way of doing this.
But paragraph 17 says that HMRC cannot easily track and monitor compliance activity in Scotland, and this affects its ability to collect performance data about the extent of Scottish non-compliance. Now, without data, you can't really project accurately into the future.
Intuitively, without knowing the ins and outs of all of these systems in great detail, it does seem surprising that it isn't possible to isolate Scotland compliance activity from the UK whole. But the fact is, the HMRC compliance systems are built on a national, a UK-wide basis, and were never designed to be applied differently in different parts of the UK. That may become inappropriate at some point. So I think this is a really important point to stay on, as the facts change, as the risks change. Because you're right, it's intuitively surprising that their compliance system isn't able to identify the country of the taxpayer.
And if I move to part one, 1.5. It states here that the reduction in Scottish income tax outturn arising from these adjustments, and this is estimates for tax due and so on, uncollected amounts, tax reliefs. It says here in some areas of the calculation, HMRC does not have data available in sufficient detail to identify income tax liabilities, reliefs or other adjustments relating to individual taxpayers. Now, again, they're using UK figures to try to work out some sort of calculation on that. But again, the pattern of Scottish taxpayers versus UK, the rest of the UK, is very different as far as the information we've seen here is concerned. How accurate can that be? What kind of distortion is there that comes in there?
That figure you're referring to is it's the one bit of the outturn that is estimated. As I said, 99% of the outturn is based on actual figures. This is the remaining 1% that's based on estimates. And figure three in our report breaks down that 119 million adjustment into the categories of adjustment of estimates. So you've got estimated self-assessment liabilities, estimated PAYE liabilities, and then a category of estimated further liabilities, things like tax relief on pension contributions, gift aid, and so on. And then some deductions from revenue, deductions from revenue based on on pension contributions. So it is possible to break down that estimate into its constituent categories. And what we're pointing out is that some of those estimates, because these are estimates of liabilities that haven't yet materialised in their final form. So, for example, self-assessment taxpayers who have been very late with concluding their tax return. So the figure isn't known, and so it can't be accurately entered into the calculation. But UK-wide, HMRC knows that there's a level of late filing of tax returns that it can reasonably accurately predict. What it's saying is they can't separate that assumption between Scotland and the UK, so they're applying a UK-wide proportion to the figure to derive this Scotland amount. That's the process they're in at the moment. So the question is, should they be able to accurately forecast things like late filing of tax returns and how much tax will arise from those late returns? You can see why that's not straightforward, because they don't have an actual number that they can attribute to Scottish taxpayers in that case. But again, this is all, this whole system needs to be kept under review. I don't know if you want to add to that, Darren.
I think that's fair. We've talked about this with the committee before, and I agree it is an area to continue to probe. There is a high level of assurance around the net outturn for those residual areas of estimation and adjustment. I think the judgment that HMRC and the Scottish Government reach in deciding whether to go further with this is one around the precision of the outturn figure versus timeliness. So in theory, if you take the example of you won't know, if there's a compliance case ongoing on a self-assessment tax return, that could take up to 6 years to settle. You could wait until the end of that six-year period and have absolute clarity around the amount that is due, but that would have consequences for budgeting and planning and things of that nature. So I think the judgment that HMRC and the Scottish Government reaches, there is a balance between the timeliness and the precision of producing the outturn.
I mean, continuing to look at deductions from revenue, if I look at 1.15 and 1.16. HMRC's used historical data for the UK as a whole to determine the patterns of uncollected liabilities. And then they've apportioned that against Scottish taxpayers, and they've calculated that 97 million. And in paragraph 1.16, HMRC, this is in connection with gift aid and so on, which is not insignificant. They've calculated these deductions by estimating the Scottish share of tax relief claimed across the UK, again using historic data. And they've calculated this out to be a deduction of 114 and one on gift aid and 155 million in pension contributions. But it's unclear to me, again, the pattern across the UK is not really the same. It becomes one sort of amorphous figure when you put it all together, but when you try and separate it out and then take one part to compare against the other, it cannot be accurate. There must be a margin for error in this.
That's absolutely true. Like any estimate, one thing you could be pretty sure of, it won't be absolutely the correct figure by definition almost. I think all of these questions come down to this balance of cost and timeliness. And so how important is the accuracy if it means it's going to be late or expensive to get the figure? That's really what all of these come down to. And so you might get a bit of extra accuracy, but at what price and with what delay? And clearly it can't be a long delay, because you do need the figure to complete the Scottish Government accounting process. So I think these are completely valid questions about how has that balance been struck in each of these cases. And some of them seem more surprising than others to the layperson, I think. That some of these, it's hard to understand why there isn't Scottish data available straight off the system. In other cases, it's a bit easier to see why it's quite difficult to arrive at that. So I think as systems improve, of course, as because they are over time, systems are becoming more sophisticated, ability to interrogate the data is stronger. I think it's important to keep challenging the Scottish Government and HMRC on why they have not made a different call on some of these estimate areas, because I would expect over time that some of these become quite cheap to produce and should be just routinely fed into the calculation rather than estimated, whereas others might continue to be problematic and expensive. So I think this is a live conversation to maintain with the policymakers.
Now, if I go through this report and compare what I regard as anomalies with what I took out last year, am I going to see any improvement?
Which anomalies were you thinking of?
Well, I took out, I said at the beginning, I took out 32 cases where parts of the returns, parts of the revenue are estimated and liabilities are estimated to an extent that if you take one issue, it's not that big. If you take 32, you're looking at a bigger distortion. And I would hope that over a period, that would gradually reduce with experience and with an understanding that there's areas there to be sorted.
Yes, I mean, I think that we haven't seen any big changes in the approach in this year we're reporting compared to the previous year, as we said earlier on. But I think you're right. I think that over time you should see a reduction in the length of the list of estimated areas as it becomes more possible to use the system to home in on the actual figure. And even where you do still, I mean, some of these you'll still need to include an estimate because you're estimating something that hasn't happened yet. Even in those cases, it should be possible to use Scotland-only data rather than an apportionment of the UK figure. So I think in those two areas, I think you should expect to see improvements over time as the improvements to the system allow.
As the auditor, have you had these conversations with HMRC and the Scottish Government?
We haven't had them with the Scottish Government because our remit doesn't take us there. But as the auditor of HMRC, this is the stuff of all of our conversations with them. Clearly, we audit them for the accuracy of their accounts and for exercises of the kind we're discussing today. But we also carry out value for money audits on HMRC as we do of every other UK government department. And the Public Accounts Committee in Westminster holds hearings based on those reports on a regular basis. So we challenge HMRC all the time on could they be doing more to ensure that the revenue due is collected, to minimise the compliance losses that we've been discussing, to reduce the tax debt figure that has grown so significantly since the pandemic. So all of these areas, and then at the heart of all of that, of course, is the system of IT and data collection. One of the biggest IT operations in the country, of course, at HMRC, hugely sophisticated systems nowadays, and a programme to continue to improve those. So we are very close to the planned improvements in those systems, and we challenge HMRC on a regular basis as their auditor on what they're doing to address the risks that arise using the better data they have available. Darren, I mean, you're their auditor, so do you have anything to add to that?
I was just going to return to the point around evidence which suggests that the quality of the estimates and the data is improving over time. So I think it's absolutely valid to continue to reflect on the residual areas of estimation in the outturn. I guess I just wanted to draw your attention to the overall variance in HMRC's estimate of what Scottish income tax outturn would be for 2021 and what it actually was. So I think in absolute terms, it was a difference of 87 million, which is clearly in pounds and pence is a significant sum. In percentage terms, the variance is 0.7%, and that's the lowest that it's ever been, certainly in my involvement in this particular piece of work, and that has shown some steady improvement over time. So it does give a, whilst the methodology hasn't changed substantially. The quality of the overall estimate, there is some evidence that that's improving over time, which I think is important to reflect.
Perhaps in relation to this, engaging with the Scottish Government on this, the Auditor General Scotland could comment.
Mr. Bitty, ultimately, looking at the reliability of the estimate, firstly, informs the government in Scotland the budget it proposes for its public spending, and as we've seen over a number of years now, that's resulted in fairly large negative budget adjustments and reconciliations once tallied up with the subsequent outturn. We covered in our own report today, for the first time we have a positive budget adjustment of 50 million. What we're not seeing yet is that that's necessarily going to be a reliable indicator of future positive reconciliations, given the volatility that we've covered already. In terms of conversations with the government, primarily the vehicle for that is our additional assurance report that the committee has today, that we set out clearly our view that for the government, Scottish Government, to be satisfied that the robustness of the methodology, the associated compliance activities, the cost-benefit arrangements that we've touched on already this morning in terms of what they're asking of HMRC, and that the data is robust to support overall budgeting for the Scottish budget. It's something of a moving feast. I think as we look at the totality of today's reports, I think we're seeing more volatility, more divergence and change, and therefore a view for the Scottish Government to take as to whether the existing arrangements are sufficient for their purpose. I think you've probably seen from both the National Audit Office and ourselves a sense that this increasing complexity and volatility might lead itself to more compliance and more requirements that the Scottish Government should ask of HMRC.
I'll stop there because obviously a lot of the questions really are for the HMRC to respond to. I'll simply say that there seems to be huge inaccuracies within the calculations for the Scottish rate of income tax, and that a great deal of work needs to be done to get an accurate Scottish figure.
Thank you. Before we leave that theme altogether, so the tax gap, which is the difference between the amount of tax that should be paid and what is actually paid, you say in para 2.3.2 that HMRC does not currently produce a Scotland-specific tax gap figure, and you also go on to say that HMRC has limited information on total compliance activity undertaken in Scotland. I mean, I just wonder whether you, both the Auditor General for Scotland as well as the Comptroller and Auditor General from the NAO, whether you've got a view on whether that would be useful to have that specific Scottish tax gap data, for example.
Well, I'll say something about the UK approach to calculating the tax gap. I mean, I think by tax gap, what HMRC means is if everybody paid the tax that was intended by government or governments across the UK, what would be collected? And then compare that with what they've actually collected, and that's the tax gap. And it's measured in the tens of billions, typically 30-something billion at the moment each year. So that's a measure of the UK-wide tax gap. And clearly you close that by improving compliance with tax rules, minimising avoidance, and so on. So the way that's calculated, it's essentially a statistical exercise carried out in the UK. It's quite a controversial methodology, a lot of academic challenge to it every time it's used, plenty of people with ideas on how it could be improved. And so that's a very live debate all the time between HMRC and the community of people interested in the accuracy of that number. And I think what HMRC's view is that that's a hard enough challenge, coming up with an acceptable figure for the UK. They really struggle to see how they could come up with a Scottish-only version of this statistical estimate, because so many of the figures used are UK-wide assumptions. Now, of course, in theory, absolutely nothing to stop somebody trying to do that, but HMRC have said, well, the cost and effort involved in doing that and the likely kind of methodological challenges they would face means that they don't think there's a good case for doing that at the moment. But clearly this is a discussion, they like all of these matters, a discussion between HMRC and the Scottish Government.
Yeah, thanks, Kabir. Not a terrific amount to add to that. I think Gareth set out the complexity and the reasons why that hasn't been taken forward. The Scottish Government would have to be clear that the benefits would outweigh the costs in assessing whether that was an exercise that would derive further benefit in establishing a more robust estimate, first of all, for its purposes, and then be satisfied that the extent of tax available to Scotland is in theoretical terms, is clearly stated. So I'm somewhat sitting on the fence on it, Convener, actually, and I think it is one for government to weigh up the pros and cons, if that would support its wider understanding of the methodology and feeding through to its estimate of Scottish tax.
Thank you. And it goes back to the earlier conversation we had about the service level agreement and whether if there was additional payment made to HMRC, whether that could elicit maybe that kind of, notwithstanding some of the methodological challenges, that kind of data, it seems to us, I think, would be fundamentally useful data to have. Before I bring Willie Coffey in, there was just one other area I wanted to raise with you, and it's been mentioned almost in the passing so far, and that's the whole issue of debt collection. And I was looking at the, I think somebody mentioned earlier on, the Public Accounts Committee and the regular reporting which there is to it from HMRC, NAO, of course, and other government bodies. And I'm looking at the government responds to last year's 48th report of session 2021-22, which was a reflection on where things had got to there with tax collection. One of the things which is highlighted in the UK government's response is this. It says, in addition from September 2022, there will be a new contract through which HMRC places debt with private debt collection agencies. This will allow HMRC to increase placements with debt collection agencies by around £1 billion a year without increasing the cost to the Exchequer. So I guess my questions are, so are these debt collection agencies doing it for free if there's no cost of the Exchequer, or are they taking a percentage of everything that's collected, which I think is normally what happens in these situations? Are they operational in Scotland? Are you aware whether or not the Scottish Government has got a view about the deployment of private debt collection agencies, and who principally are they?
I don't have those details to hand, but Darren, I don't know if you're able to help on any of those points.
So those are arrangements we're looking at as part of the current 22-23 audit rounds. I think I could say with relative certainty that they won't be free, but I'm not party to the specifics of the commercial arrangements. Your questions around the distribution of that activity between Scotland and the rest of the UK is something, it's probably a question more for HMRC, but certainly something we'll be interested in as part of our audit.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, again, obviously the committee will consider what its next steps are with this, but I think there would be interest in understanding whether private debt collection agencies are now being deployed. Auditor General for Scotland.
Thanks, Convener. I think you'd asked about whether the Scottish Government had a view on whether private debt collection agencies were operational in Scotland. I don't think we know the answer to that, but I think it's perhaps also worth checking with the Scottish Government whether they are able to have a view on that, given it might just be a case of this is a HMRC collecting income tax through its own arrangements across the whole of the UK. So it's probably one for the government, Scottish Government, to confirm.
Yeah, I think it does pose some wider questions and, again, some policy questions. Willie Coffey's got a number of questions he wants to put. Willie.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to the panel. I wonder if I could drag you back to the opening remarks and the two big figures that are in the very front pages of the report. Again, please, it's the HMRC's final outturn calculation at £11.9 billion and the estimate being £13.2 billion. Now, that difference is substantial. It's £1.3 billion. My simple question to you on behalf of the man and woman in the street, is that ultimately real money that the Scottish Government will see further along the line or not?
Well, if HMRC's estimation accuracy is maintained at the level of the last couple of years, then yes, they will, because the estimates, as we've already discussed, have been quite accurate in recent years, and increasingly so. So the difference between outturn and estimate was only 0.7% in the last year. We think this is a more challenging test of that estimation accuracy, for the reasons I said at the start. Clearly a big swing of 11.3% in 1 year is very substantial. And so there are a lot of moving parts in there, and the risk of the estimate not being as close to the outturn must be higher. But we don't have any information to point in either direction. So I can't give you a steer on whether it's optimistic or pessimistic. But we do know that it's a sterner test of the estimation methodology than the previous year. So it'll be very interesting to see how close. I mean, clearly, there's a lot riding on this, more than just the academic interest of an estimate. But it will be a much better test of the methodology that's used, given the scale of the increase in 1 year.
It's a substantial difference, though.
Yeah, and the reason we haven't flagged it up as incredible, you know, as in other words, you know, not worth believing, is because it is a similar picture in the UK as a whole. So, and as we've already pointed out, actually an even larger overall increase in the UK as a whole. So this does represent the shift in economic activity between 2021 and 2022, coming out of the harshest of the lockdowns. Interestingly, in the inflation discussion, it was kind of post-lockdown but pre-heavy inflation for most of 21-22. So it'll be very interesting. That's why we think this is going to be quite a hard one to call, because inflation was just starting to take off towards the end of that financial year. It's only in 22-23 that we've seen the highest levels. But so given how fast things were moving at the end of that year, we think this is a very challenging estimate to get right.
It sounds as though it could be a potential windfall further down the line. When would we expect to see the real figure emerge, do you think?
This time next year. So next year's report will include the outturn for 21-22, and we'll be able to compare that with this estimate of 13.3 billion that we're showing in this report. So it's a year. And clearly, indications, HMRC will be getting indications of this much sooner than this time next year, because we've passed the deadline date for self-assessment returns to be submitted to HMRC, which was the end of last month. And so HMRC at the moment is finalising the tax liabilities for all those taxpayers. And so we'll have an emerging indication as we go through this year.
Yes, and the £50 million figure, the actual positive differential, Stephen, that you mentioned, is that an example of this?
So I think that relates to the 11.95 billion pounds relative to what had been assumed. So as we discussed, the first time there's been a positive reconciliation to the Scottish budget, so significant in and of itself. If I may, Mr. Coffin, may return to the estimate point, and Mark might want to say a bit more about this in a moment. But I suppose if you're looking for evidence, it's hard for anyone to be categoric that the estimate that's set out here will be what's actually received once HMRC collects all the relevant tax. But in terms of corroborating positions, the Scottish Fiscal Commission's estimate is very close to the estimate that's set out from HMRC. So I think it provides more confidence to the Scottish Government when it's setting its budget that won't result in hundreds of millions of pounds of reconciliations either way. But with any estimate, there's always a degree of uncertainty, especially this year with all of the external variables that we've discussed already. I think Mark can say a bit more about that.
Yeah, just really to develop that point, and it's paragraph 23 of the Auditor General's report quotes the most recent figure from the Fiscal Commission, which of course, well, two things to say about that is the Fiscal Commission will regularly update its forecasts from the initial one it prepares that hits the Scottish budget as to how that's playing out in their assessment of that. And I think the other thing to say about that is that their approach is very different to HMRC's. Their approach is founded in the administrative data of that they receive on an ongoing basis, and is much more granular in their overall assessment and is underpinned by their overall modelling. And the fact that those two numbers are very close should give you a degree of assurance over it. Whether that continues to be the case going forward is the big question that sits alongside that. I think the other thing, again, just to pull out with your indulgence, Convener, is that, of course, the Scottish tax take matters, and the UK tax take matters too, and it's the interplay between those two. And again, the Scottish Fiscal Commission will look at what both the initial assessment of that differences and what it means for the Scottish budget, and that's placed through individual Scottish budgets, but also in the final reconciliation, they will continue to forecast how that's likely to land. We've seen the first positive reconciliation. There's a big negative reconciliation currently forecast for the subsequent year. And after that, you'll see a degree of volatility in that. The system's designed that sometimes it will be up and sometimes it will be down because it's based on that interplay of two estimates. But I think from a financial planning perspective, the Scottish Government needs to be very aware of that big negative reconciliation that's forecast for the next budget year, which is 24-25. Is planning for that. It's in the order of £750 million is currently forecast. Part of the reason for that is that there was discretion with Scottish ministers as a result of timing difference around a UK budget to take an earlier figure or a later figure, and they took an earlier figure which gave more money up front. But as the reconciliation plays through, that's likely to add a significant challenge to next year's budget setting process.
Okay, thank you very much for helping to clarify that. I wonder if I could turn to ask you a couple of questions about the Scottish S codes and the application of these by employers in Scotland. The numbers appear to be going up. The paper we have in front of us says that it was about 39,000 or so previously, and it's up to 41,000. These are employers that don't apply the Scottish S tax code to their employees. I wonder if you have a view about why this is continuing to be the case. Is it the same sectors that are perhaps not applying this? And is there any information that you or anyone else could give the committee to help us understand what's going on here and what work is going on to try and fix this particular problem?
So I guess I'll start with that position has improved over time as employers have become more familiar with how the system works and the requirements of them to apply the S code. That number is still high and needs to be continually borne down on, so I think that's absolutely right. In terms of what HMRC does, my understanding from the work that we've done is that it will target routine offenders, so if employers are consistently getting it wrong, then they will reach out to them directly and intervene directly, albeit my understanding is that the frequency of that or the instances of that have reduced over time. It also issues things like employer newsletters, which it calls nudge campaigns, which remind employers of their responsibilities in running their payrolls. I guess the overarching thing I would say on this is that there is a high level of assurance around which taxpayers should have the S code applied, and therefore if employers aren't getting it right, when HMRC comes to reconcile its own records to what employers have applied, there's a high level of assurance around the accuracy of that and how that feeds into the Scottish income tax outturn. It would be really unfortunate for the individual employees who haven't had the correct code applied, because that could mean that for a period of time throughout the tax year, they've either been under or overpaying their tax, and that could clearly be a surprise to them and an unwelcome one at that. So, yeah, sorry.
I was just going to say, Darren, to follow up, that the number's actually going up, not down. It was 39,000, it's now 41,000 of these inappropriately applied S codes by employers in Scotland. And I just wonder if you are able to dig any deeper about who these groups of people are. Is it the same repeat employers year on year? And why isn't this number significantly coming down by now?
That is something that we look at as part of the as part of our audit work. And just to go back to your point around, it's increased year on year, but the trend has decreased over a period of time. Is what I was pointing to.
Is there further information that we could get either from yourselves or HMRC about the categories and groups of employees?
I think HMRC could certainly elaborate on what's driving it. Absolutely.
I think we asked it last year, convener, but I don't recall if a response came to that. So we're clearly interested in why and whether employers are habitually not applying the Scottish S code to their employees' tax returns. Is there anything else you could add on to that, Auditor General?
Yeah. I think it's primarily one for the National Audit Office and HMRC, Mr. Coffey. I think It'd be interesting to see whether HMRC's position has changed. If you do have any further inquiries, I think as the NEO set out in their report, HMRC's position is that the number of employers that routinely use an incorrect tax code is very low, and they're not routinely tracking that information. Perhaps this takes us back into the cost-benefit position as to whether or not, with their compliance activity, and indeed the compliance activity that the Scottish Government asks, whether this is an area that they would look for more information. None of that detracts, I think, from the overall point that you're making, actually, is that the reliability and robustness of the Scottish tax base is fundamental to both the outturn and then the reliability of the estimate. I think as a package of measures for the Scottish Government to take a view on, are they satisfied about the overall reliability of the estimate that then produces the numbers to support the Scottish budget?
I mean, just finally on that point, Convener, I would certainly be interested, I'm sure colleagues would be too, if there was a few numbers of employers who had high numbers of employees that were habitually not applying the code. That I'm sure that would be of interest to the committee to try and help resolve that. But we don't know, we don't see that level of detail, but that's perhaps something we could follow up on, Convener, if we get the opportunity. My last question to you is about the parliamentarians and the correct application of the S code to them. You'll probably recall that in the early days, 45 of our dearly beloved colleagues in this Parliament were not regarded as Scottish taxpayers. And just to ask, probably finally, is that problem completely resolved and solved now for Scottish MSPs in the Scottish Parliament and Scottish MPs that serve at Westminster? Do we know who they all are, and are we applying an S code to them all?
So you'll be unsurprised to hear that since that happened a number of years ago, what used to be a manual process is now automated and has more scrutiny from both HMRC, and we certainly look at it on an annual basis. It's something we are keenly interested in. Since that time, I haven't identified, I've been made aware of any issues around MSP's coding.
Okay. Thank you very much for that. Thank you. Back to you, Convener.
Right, thank you very much indeed. I think, if any other members of the committee have got any final questions, if they could indicate. I just wanted to touch on something, Auditor General for Scotland, in your report, I think paragraph 42, which is a section on taxpayer behaviour, where you say, in my view, the publication of the income tax behavioural analysis and the development of a data set to track taxpayer responses to income tax changes over time is a positive development. Can I just check with you where that is? I mean, I've not seen anything published yet, but is there an expectation that something will be published later this year? And, but has the work been commissioned to get that data set and to have that out in the public domain?
Yeah, a couple of things to touch on, Convener. I think in the preceding paragraphs, we referred to the publication of Scottish taxpayer liabilities and behaviour over time that HMRC published in December of 2021. And this is but it begins to explore the behavioural change, the incentives that we've covered in part this morning. Some of that will be about addresses that people will use for their tax base. But other parts, I think we maybe haven't featured so prominently today, is actually the incentives that people, behavioural change that encompasses the extent of hours worked in Scotland relative to other parts of the UK to mitigate tax base, tax paid relative to income. And then the other part, it talks about HMRC's work with devolved governments in the UK. Scotland is further ahead than Wales in terms of applying its divergence from the rest of the UK in income tax rates. The HMRC is working with devolved governments as part of a working group just to establish the reliability of data sets, anticipated outturn statistics. All of this points to an ongoing need, really, for the Scottish Government as a customer, fundamentally, in this exercise, to satisfy itself that it's getting from HMRC reliable estimates, that the outturn is consistent with the methodology and that they can then produce a Scottish budget that will be as close as it possibly can be to what they'll ultimately receive in income tax returns. So work happening, I would say, convener. What we want to see next is that the government is satisfied that what's produced and more to come later this summer is consistent with their expectations in this changing environment.
Thank you very much indeed. And I think on that note of great clarity, I want to draw this morning's evidence session to a close. And can I thank our witnesses, Darren Stewart, Gareth Davies from the NAO, Stephen Boyle and Mark Taylor from Audit Scotland. It's been a very useful session for us. I think it provides us with a platform upon which we will want to build. But thank you once again, and I now move the committee into private session.